Sunday night, and we are studying on our statement of faith. We've been in this for several months. Our statement of faith is unlike anybody else's statement of faith. A statement of faith are the things that you believe. I guess the thing I believe more than anything else is, I'll get me a pen that'll write here, is defining words, culture, customs, idioms, metaphors, figures of speech in general, what things mean. You got to go back 2,000 years to their society. People say, we don't live in the ancient world. We speak English today, and that's your ignorance, too, speaking out. You got to go back to their day and time, look at the Greek text, and you say, I don't know Greek. I can show anybody how to look up Greek words in 30 minutes, and you'll never have to speak a word of Greek, but I can show you how to look them up in a concordance. Now, people will write to them, and they'll say, well, I couldn't find this in a concordance. Well, I don't just use a concordance. I've got a library with several thousand books in my library. I've got all kinds of word study books. A concordance is a basic book to look up basic words and basic definitions, but it doesn't always give you the fullest definition. Now, Mr. Strong, who came out with the Strong's Concordance, a wonderful book, and I look at the basics of it, and I look up a word, but... And he certainly is an authority, but sometimes he'll give a real shallow definition in his concordance. Maybe it's too simple of a definition, but then again, he's got a 12-volume set, same man, of Cyclopedia of Biblical, Theological, and Ecclesiastical Literature. You can look up sometimes the word in here. In fact, if you look up the word agape in his book, it'll have a little short definition. One of the words that's been translated love. And he doesn't give a good definition in his concordance. He gives a better definition in his 12-volume set. And Mr. Strong is not the only man that, it's 12 volumes up here. He's not the only contributor to this. There are probably several hundred contributors. So a man will write one section, another man will write on another section. And it takes years of research to put something like this together. Then you've got Kittle's Dictionary, New Testament, a dictionary of Greek Dictionary of New Testament Greek Words. That's 12 volumes. If you look up agape in that, it'll give you 34 pages just on agape. 34. As opposed to the little definition he'll give you here. I'm not satisfied with the definition he gives in this, in his concordance. I'm not totally satisfied with the one he gives in here, but I like the one that he gives in, that Kittles gives, the 12-volume set on New Testament Greek words. But the best definition for agape, you get out of context. I had a Greek professor tell me one time, you'll find sometimes a better definition in the context of Scripture. When agape, the best definition I've ever found is out of the Bible itself. Agape and phileo. And phileo. Both of these words were translated into one word in the Greek, love. You cannot take our word love and translate it back to the Greek. It's not translatable. And agape sometimes will be translated charity. Every time you find charity, it is agape. And you have to look up the word, and you get kind of used to finding which one is which. Phileo means affection, or to like something. I've said this so many times. I like God. I like my wife. I like my dog. I like to get drunk. I like beer. I like drugs. I like go fishing. I like anything. And we get the word philos from this, which is the word friend. It means to have affection. Well, that can be concerning anything that you can think of. Agape has to do with, like I said, you can look it up in Strong's Encyclopedia, Strong's Concordance, Kittles. Or you can pay real close attention when you're reading 2 John 6. This is agape. This is love. This is love that we walk after his commandments. And then when you go to Mr. Kittle, he will tell you in essence that agape was a term that was used to show a relationship between a father and his children. If he loved his sons, he'd give them laws in the family. He would leave his business to his sons, say, "Sons, here is my business, and I'm going to teach you in this as you grow up. I'm going to teach you to be a carpenter, teach you to be the best ones." That was agape to the sons. Or a king to his subjects. King to subjects. And you even had, I taught one time on evil agape. Evil agape. The agape wasn't so much evil. It was the faithfulness to it. The Bible says, if you love those that love you, what do you more than the Pharisees? When the scripture says that, it uses this agape. Pharisees had an agape. You had to get along with them, do the things that they said. And like I've said before, the mob, the mafia, has an agape. You have to go along with them. And if in the mob, if you divulge the secrets of the mob, then they'll kill you. When you become a made man, they make you hold your hand out. I read all about the mob for years, and I kept up with the heads of the families and who was being killed off by who and so forth. And they would put a paper in your hand, they would burn it in your hands, and you would say, if I ever divulge these secrets, I will burn like this paper burns. And there was one man that came up and divulged the secrets. We had never heard the word La Cosa Nostra until one of the guys who just was a driver for the mob. He was a made man, but his name was Joe Valachi. In 1964, Joe Valachi, he revealed La Cosa Nostra. They did what they said they were going to do. If you revealed it, they're going to kill you. Well, Joe was in prison down in Atlanta, and that's where Vito Genovese, who was head of the big mob, the one that John Gotti kind of became head of in New York, and Vito Genovese, who had put a hit on Joe Valachi when Joe said he hadn't done anything. He said he wasn't guilty, but if you didn't take the hit, they'd kill your family. The only problem is Joe Valachi didn't have any family, no kinfolks. So he had nothing to lose, so he squealed on the mob, comes out and tells them about La Cosa Nostra, and they start in after Joe. And the federal government had taken from one prison to another, one federal prison to another, because his life was in jeopardy at all times, and these were prisons that were run by the military. And as soon as they'd hear that he was going to be found out, that he was being checked out in a prison, do you know what a colonel would, you know how much he had revealed for $1 million or $2 million or $3 million, and that was no money to the mob? He'd reveal anything. He'd open the gate and let you go in there and kill him. So they switched Joe from one prison to the other while he was an old man. He finally died of old age in prison. But that's a type of an agape that would be an evil agape. But our agape is righteous towards God, and it has to do with walking in the commandments of God. Now, nobody told me this. I just understand this when I think of this. I didn't read this part out of a book. Didn't even read this part out of a book. A lot of the things that I say to you is simply analytical thinking. If we walk after the commandments of God, everybody says, you mean we walk after thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal? Yes, we do. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not. All the thou shalt nots we walk after. But I keep saying, the commandments of God are much more than the Old Testament. It's much more. And it's much more than just the Ten Commandments. It's more than that. In fact, the Ten Commandments are divided up into sections. The first four are about loving God. Loving God. And the second six are about loving your neighbor. And remember, Jesus said, all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. If you love your neighbor, you're not going to covet what they've got. You're not going to lie to them. You're not going to steal from them. And when you fulfill the second six, you will fulfill the first four. It's really that simple. But not only will you do that, you'll fulfill all of the imperative moods in the Greek. You say, Jim, I don't know what an imperative mood is. I understand that. An imperative mood is a command. I've said this so many times that when I was in elementary school, I remember the teacher saying, you got four types of sentences. You got a statement. Statement. And it ends in a period. Jim went to the store. And then you have an exclamation. An exclamation ends with an exclamation point. And it's like a surprise. Jim went to the store and we didn't even ask him to. Jim went to the store. I thought he's going over to so-and-so. And then you have an interrogative. Interrogative, we get the word interrogate from that. Interrogative. Did Jim go to the store? And then you have an imperative mood. It's the same as in the Greek. It's a command. Eric, go to the store, get some bread. I'll do it later. Now. That's a command. What if Jesus, if the Bible has imperative moods in it, and it does, all over the New Testament, hundreds of them, if this is God's word, and he says, strive to enter at the straight gate, that's an imperative mood. Humble yourself under the hand of God, that's an imperative mood. But you can't make them imperatives just because you want them to be an imperative. You got to look up the actual word in your interlinear Bible and see how it's spelled. You see how it's spelled in your interlinear. Get the exact spelling on it. And you take a parsing guide, which is an analytical lexicon. I got one here. You look up the exact spelling in it. And it will say, if it's an imperative, it'll say IMP. That means it is a command. That means this is the same God that writing in the New Testament, inspiring the Holy Spirit to write. Anytime you have an imperative mood, it's not an invitation. It's the living God commanding us, just like he said, let there be light. And when he says to us in our lives, let there be light in our hearts, it may not be something that happens all of a sudden, but it happens gradually over a long period of time. You start off with a little light or little faith, oligos pistis, little light, and it gets brighter and brighter the longer you live in truth, and the darkness you live in gets dimmer and dimmer, and you increase in faith. Now, there's a guy on the internet, he says he don't believe in increasing in faith. Anyway, he looks like a guy, and he don't believe in increasing in faith. And the Bible says when your faith is increased, 2 Corinthians, the 10th chapter, then you'll cease to put me down, and you'll exalt me, Paul, as a preacher of truth. Now, I believe, not only in defining words, find out the parts of speech. And every time, this is agape, that we walk after the commandments of God. You say, Jim, do I have to look up all the imperative moods? No. But if you are a believer, it will be happening in your heart And you'll be knowing as you're walking along in life that you got to learn to behave yourself and stop doing some of the things you used to do. And that's the outer man. And you're going to have to learn that. Now, whenever I define these words, we've been in a statement of faith about what we believe. America don't believe in defining anything. Baptist preachers very seldom ever. I've had people say, my preacher teaches the Greek like you. What they mean is, oh, about once every 6 or 8 months, he puts out one Greek word. And he'll say, and usually it's agape. And they'll say, there's agape and phileo, and phileo is affection. And agape is a godly kind of love. And that's what it is. Ain't that good? Have you ever heard some preacher say that? It's a godly kind of love. It has an exact meaning to it. Now, I said all that to say all this. Back to 1 Corinthians 14. Paul is having a problem in 1 Corinthians 14 with people learning how to define words all through this book. People don't know what anything means. They don't know what confess means. I never met a preacher that knew what confess meant. If thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. They say, see, we got to give you an invitation. Him, you got to walk down the aisle and confess Jesus down here at this altar. First of all, that's not an altar. Your daily cross is your altar. And when you go out in the world, you tell people the truth, Christmas is pagan, Easter is pagan, God doesn't love everybody. Yeah, they crucify you on that altar out there, down there at Kroger's, down there at the grocery store, down in the middle of the street. That's where they crucify. You don't get crucified down at the front of a church. There's no altar down there. Not even supposed to be. Anyway, here in 1 Corinthians 14, we've been talking about, I believe that one of the most confusing doctrines, one of the most confusing so-called statements of faith, I call it so-called because there's no faith in it, is the charismatic doctrine. They teach faith healing. They teach tongues. Don't believe in any of that. When you start defining words, you find out it's not true. Faith healing. There's no such thing as faith healing. We do not believe that. I said this to somebody the other day. I think it was a guy that goes to a charismatic church. I can't remember who it was. And I said, every time the Bible says thy faith has made thee whole, every time the word whole is sozo. Sozo is the word saved. And I said, when Jesus said thy faith has made thee whole to the woman with the issue of blood, and then he said, go be in whole of thy plague. That second word, whole, is not the word sozo. It's the same English word in Mark, the 5th chapter, same English word, but it's not the same word in the Greek. Her faith saved her. And he says, now I'm a living God. You can't come in contact with me, especially when you're a believer, and not be physically cleansed, hugius. He said, now go, now that I've saved you, go and be hugius. Hygiene comes from that. Be physically cleansed from your plague. But she wasn't physically cleansed because of her faith. She was saved because of her faith. And that's every time you find that. But I told this fellow, I said, you've been in Pentecostal churches. I said, it's amazing that Pentecostals, when they are 30 years old and they're sick. Now, this is a Pentecostal person. They say that they can be healed because of their faith. They can be healed in some meeting when they're 30. That's because they're involved in their imagination. The same person lives on and on and on. And after you get to be 90 or 95, your faith should be stronger over here, shouldn't it? Should be stronger. Your faith should grow as you get older. What amazes me, and I said this to him, I said, when they get to be 90 or 95, they get sick, and they're involved in natural diseases. They get involved in diseases, They have heart disease. They have valve problem. Heart valve is out of whack. And they have high blood pressure. High blood pressure. And their blood pressure spiking all the time. They have cholesterol problems. And they have all kinds of ailments. And they can't be healed here at 90, 95 because they're dying. But when you die of old age, you die of a disease. Everybody dies of a disease when they die of old age. Does that tell you anything? He said, well, guys, I never thought of that before. It's ridiculous. The two most famous faith healers of the 20th century, Oral Roberts, Kenneth Hagin. Kenneth Hagin came up with the positive confession movement. All you got to do is say it and you get it. And then it passed to Oral Roberts, and he was bigger than Hagin as far as name-wise. And they both died of a disease. Oral Roberts died of pulmonary disease. Kenneth Hagin died of heart disease. Duh. Now, why couldn't they call Jesse the plant in? He's got the IQ of a plant. Call him in and have him pray for him and get Fred Price and Jesse Duplantis and Rod Parsley and all those guys to lay hands on him and heal him. Because they were old, they were dying of a disease. They lost their faith, I guess. Isn't that crazy? It doesn't take a genius to figure that out. One time my little brother, who is one of the singers at TBN, his name is Dean Brown. Dean called me when I was in the hospital in my mid-40s. Dean said, Jimmy, if you'll receive your healing, you'll be made whole. I said, Dean, which word are you talking about, whole, in the New Testament? There's five Greek words for the word whole. You have the word hugius. You have the word sozo. You have the word eiomai, and a couple others. I said, which one are you talking about? And he said, I can't talk to you, and he slammed the phone down. It's like they pay no attention to definition. None. They don't care. One of their worst doctrines is tongues. I could go calling things that be not as though they were. That's the dumbest thing I've ever heard in my life. They say, you can call things that be not as though they were. Huh? Yeah, come on. Say, just say Cadillac, I get a Cadillac. You guys are stupid. I guess I ought to go ahead and bring that out. That's in Romans 4. Romans 4. I'll get just to show how dumb these people are. It doesn't say what they're talking about. Look here in Romans 4. I like to bring this out once in a while because we're talking about defining words. But you'll find the answer to this in the text of Scripture. Romans 4, speaking about the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all, in verse 16, as it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations. How did he make him a father of many nations? Through two sons, one with a promise, Isaac, one without the promise, Ishmael. Ishmael became the father of Arab nations. Isaac became the father of Israel. Israel was Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons, and they all became the nation. Before him whom he believed, even God, who quickeneth the dead and. Now what he's doing is connecting quickening the dead and calleth those things that be not as though they were. And they'll pull this verse out, say, see, you can call things that be not. You can say, I want a brand new Mercedes. I believe I'm going to get it, God, and you're going to give it to me. And I want gold trim on it, and I want gold wheels on it, and I want gold this and that. And you can stipulate to God what you want on it, and you can say it over and over and over, and you'll get it. That's not what this is talking about, you imbeciles. You say you shouldn't call them that. Could I call them children of hell? Like Jesus called the Pharisees. Can I call them that? Can I call them whited sepulchers? That within are full of dead men's bones? And they look white outwardly. They look pristine, clean. God who quickens the dead. God quickens the dead. Quicken. Z-O-O-P-O-I-E-O. That is the word quicken. It's two words, a composite of two words. Zoo, meaning alive. Poeo, meaning to make. God makes alive and calls things that be not. And the context of this is God making alive the loins of Abraham when he was 99 years old, and when Sarah, his wife, was 89 years old. He comes to him and says, Abraham, when you are 100, you're going to have a son. You don't have any more sperm, no more seed. And Sarah doesn't ovulate anymore. And it ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. No ovulation anymore. No egg. No sperm. But you're going to have a son. If God performs this, which he did, and Abraham believes him, that's raising Isaac from the dead loins of his father and the dead womb of his mother. This is called resurrection. And the resurrection is the gospel. And that fulfills, just hold your place here and go to Galatians. Hold your place, I got to come back here. Go to Galatians. Galatians 3. And look here. In verse 8. The scripture foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. The gospel that was preached to Abraham, being the resurrection according to 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4, is Isaac being raised from the dead, and something that was not was something that was dead. So calling things that be not is taking the dead and putting life in it and raising it up. It's not saying Cadillac, I get a Cadillac, I get a new Mercedes. That's idiocy. This is the context. Well, let's read the rest of this in Romans 4. God quickens the dead and calls those things which be not as though they were, who against hope believed in hope, that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead. His body was dead when it came to reproducing. When he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. And he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief. He didn't diacrino. He did not discriminate. God says, you're going to have a son. He said, all right. So calling things that be not, and you're going to find something that was not all through the scriptures. Look over in Genesis 42. Genesis 42. It amazes me they don't even look at the context. You just call it and say it, you get it. You guys are dumbbells. You know what? I'm looking at the camera. Just stupid. You say stupid? Yes, yeah, stupid. Stupid by our means, dull of hearing. They can't learn. They can't learn. They have an understanding of a brute beast. Look here in 40, in Genesis 42, 42. This is where 13, this is where the 10 brothers of Joseph come over to Egypt to get grain. Joseph is interrogating them. Says, you're spies over here. Well, he was wanting to find out if they really have repented. And he says, what about your family? In verse 13, they said, Thy servants are 12 brethren, the sons of one man, in the land of Canaan. And behold, the youngest is this day with our father, and one is not. They're talking to Joseph, not knowing who he was, and they're saying, one of our brothers is dead. Now, then they go back. Well, let me give you a couple more of these. Jeremiah 31:15. All right. Now this is where God has caused the children of Israel's children to die. Not going to go through the whole story. But let's read verse 15. Thus saith the Lord, a voice was heard in Ramah, lamentation and bitter weeping, Rachel weeping for her children, and refused to be comforted for her children, because they were not. That's the same thing Matthew the second chapter is saying. Look at Matthew the second chapter. Something that was not was something that was dead. Herod gets the message. The wise men come over in the second chapter of Matthew. They come from the far east, about 650 miles away. They didn't get to the manger. Jesus is a young child in the house. When they get to the house where the young child was in verse 11, and Jesus is about 2 years old when the wise men get to the house. Herod asks him what time the star appeared. He tells him, and then the wise men don't go back to Herod and tell him about the Christ child. They go out another way and leave. They know Herod is after the Christ child. Verse 16, then Herod, when he saw that he was mocked of the wise men, was exceeding wroth and sent forth and slew all the children. He killed the children that were in Bethlehem, all the Jewish children, in all the coasts thereof, from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had diligently inquired of the wise men earlier. That's in verse 7. Then Herod, when he had privily called the wise men, inquired them diligently what time the star appeared. It appeared 2 years earlier, so he kills all the children from 2 years old and under to make sure he gets the child who's in a house, not in a manger. Then was fulfilled that which was spoken of by Jeremiah the prophet, which we just read. In Ramah was there a voice heard, lamentation and weeping and great mourning. Rachel weeping for her children would not be comforted because they are not. They're dead. Look over here in Proverbs 12. Proverbs 12. You realize this is all through the Bible. Something was not, was dead. Proverbs 12. Well, let me see here. All right. Proverbs 12. Look at verse 7. The wicked are overthrown and are not. That means they're dead. When they're overthrown, God kills them. But the house of the righteous shall stand. And I can't go through all of these, through all the scripture. I've got them through it. Look at Jeremiah 10. Jeremiah 10. Jeremiah 10. And verse, Jeremiah 10, look here in verse 20. My tabernacle is spoiled. It's talking about God destroying Israel through Jeremiah's prophecy. And all my cords are broken. My children are gone forth of me, and they are not. There is none to stretch forth my tent anymore to set up my curtains. I've carried them away into captivity, and they're dead. Now, you're going to have this all through the Bible, something that was not. Look over in Genesis. The promise is given to Abraham in Genesis. Look here in Genesis. Go back to where the promise is in the 17th chapter, and God comes to Abraham. Says, you're going to have a son, and you're too old to have a son. And Genesis 17. Genesis 17. In verse 15. God said unto Abraham, as for Sarah thy wife, thou shalt call her name Sarai, but Sarah shall her name be. And I will bless her and give thee a son also of her. Yea, I will bless her, and she shall be a mother of nations. Kings of people shall be of her. Then Abraham fell upon his face and laughed and said in his heart, shall a child be born unto him that is 100 years old? And shall Sarah that is 90 years old bear? And Abraham said unto God, oh, that Ishmael might live and unto thee. And God says, I'll establish my covenant with Isaac. I'll bless Ishmael, but my covenant will be with Isaac. And look over here in chapter 18, verse 9. And they said unto him, these three angels that came to speak to Abraham, where is Sarah thy wife? And he said, behold, in the tent. And he said, I will certainly return according to the time of life. And lo, Sarah thy wife shall have a son. And Sarah heard it at the tent door. Now look at verse 11. Now Abraham and Sarah were old and well stricken in age, and it ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. That means she didn't ovulate anymore. She couldn't have any children, but she's going to. That's calling things that be not. That's preaching the gospel to Abraham. Calling something that be not is raising the dead. If charismatics can do that, you need, next time you have a dead person in your church, go up and start raising the dead. That's calling things that be not. That is so ignorant. Verse 14, is anything too hard for the Lord? At the time appointed. Well, let me read 13. The Lord said unto Abraham, wherefore did Sarah laugh, saying, shall I of surety bear a child when I am old? Is anything too hard for the Lord? At the time appointed, I will return unto thee according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a son, even though she can't. That's calling things that be not. Then you go over here to the 21st chapter, verse 1, the Lord visited Sarah as he had said. And she began to ovulate again. 90 years old. As he had said, and the Lord did unto Sarah as he had spoken. For Sarah conceived and bare Abraham a son in his old age at the set time, preordained. How's that for the sovereignty of God, of which God had spoken to him? Now, I mean, I can spend all night long just talking on this, and I love it. It's just the ignorance of these people is astounding to me. They don't even look at the context. They just yank any verse out, make it mean whatever they want to mean, just call things that be not as though they were. Ooh, yeah, Cadillac, come on, house, come on, car, come on, money. That's what Creflo Dollar says. He says, come on, money. And people run down there, throw money on that altar, that make-believe altar. Creflo, you're going to hell one day when you die. So are you, Kenneth Copeland. Joel Osteen, you don't have a chance. Joel Osteen did not build that church. His father did. In 1965, I had a little gospel group, and we was traveling around the country. I've got it in one of my old date books, John Osteen. What's the name of his church? Lakeside. Huh? Lakeside. Yeah, Lakeside, or whatever it is. And I got his phone number in there to call him. Everybody wanted to go there so they'd get a big offering or get a big, a moratorium or something. I wanted an offering. I'd go anywhere and sing. They were running 8,000 and 10,000 in 1965 when John Osteen was pastor. And John Osteen was crazy. He was a Baptist who turned Pentecostal. and that this is my Bible, I can do what it says I can do. That was his father's thing. Everything he does, and he knows nothing about the Word of God, nothing about the Bible. He knows nothing about calling things that be not. He knows nothing about thy faith has made thee whole. Nothing. Joel Osteen is one of the most ignorant people. He's got the largest congregation in America. And he's ignorant as some bug crawling around out there on the parking lot ground. Just dumb. But you cannot preach the truth and have a crowd. It just can't happen. Few are going to find the narrow way. Few, because they like, few is going to eliminate all these magic words that they come up with. The most evil thing in the world, the most evil thing is a man's heart. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. There's no such thing as demons. If demons are true, so are genies, so are guardian angels, so are totems, so are genius. The Romans called them geniuses. The Arabs called them genies, or jinn, J-I-N-N. Gene, get the word genie from gene, or G-E-N-I-I, or J-I-N-N, which is plural. This is plural. And what the Arabs called genies, coming from gene, that was ancestor worship. Ancestor worship. That's what the Jews call D-A-I-M-O-N-I-O-N. Daimonion comes from the root dio, meaning to distribute fortunes. Now, we can tie all this together. We can tie together distributing fortunes because the Jews call the gods, no, little G-O-D-S, they call the gods Daimonion. And the Bible even proves that they call their gods Daimonion, or what we call demons. They call their gods demons. Let me, even Paul called them demons. Look at 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter. I don't know what got me on this. I hadn't said a lot about it in a while. Go to 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter. 1 Corinthians 10. I haven't done a little bit of studying on demons. I've done a phenomenal amount of study on demons. Over the years, I've got all kinds of books on demons, all kinds of books on genies and jinn and fairies. The Celts call them fairies. If you'll notice, they all have the same characteristic. I've said this before. I'll put tongues back up here in a minute. But the Mediterranean area was all there was to the world under the rule of the Roman Empire and the Greeks and the Persians and the Romans. You've got, here's the Aegean Sea, and here's Turkey. This is Turkey. And this is Greece. Gosh, I messed up there. Take this big hand here, three-fingered hand. Then you go over here to Rome. Then you go over here to Spain. And over here, off the coast of France, is England. And this thing of demons and genies had moved throughout all the civilized world. If you're over here in the Arab countries, they called them genies, and they said that was their ancestors, which distributed fortunes. And how many wishes you get from a genie? Get three. And Eve looked at the tree, and she saw a tree that was good for food. It was pleasant to the eye, and it would make her wise. And John said in 1 John 2:16, all that's in the world. Now, if you're going to distribute fortunes, You want all that's in the world, don't you? What is all that's in the world? Well, diamonds and houses and lands and cars and money and stuff and investments and IRAs and everything you want. All that's in the world can be included under this, in the world, can be included under this right here. All that's in the world, the lust of the flesh, that would include good for food, lust of the eye, pleasant to the eye. That's what Eve saw in the tree there in Genesis, the third chapter. And the pride of life, she could be proud of herself. She could be wise in her own eyes. And this is what demons and genies, that's the three wishes of the genie. That's what you get. And everything in the world can be included under these. And we won't sit and talk about them all the time. But lust, epithumia, the common word in the Greek, epithumia means to long for that which is forbidden, or comes from thumos. And epi means to cover your life with or superimpose heavy breathing on your life. I got to have that. Well, that's all that's in the world. Everything in the world can be included. Women, cars, houses, stuff, things. Being lifted up, applauded, getting lots of awards, being somebody, being a star of some kind. That's it. What do you get from fairies? Wishes. All that's in the world. The Jews said you got to distribute fortunes, all that's in the world. The Arabs said you got it from a genie, their ancestors, and they said Hercules and Venus, and all of these were, they called them genies among the Arabs, and they had different names and different cultures, or they called them genies among the Arabs, they called them demons among the Jews, they called them fairies among the Celts. The Celts are over here in England. And they called them genies over here among the Arabs, genies. Among Israel, they called them demons. Demons are genies. If you believe in demons, you got to believe in genies. They're the same thing, a different culture. Where do you find that out? You go into all kinds of history. You go into the Encyclopedia of Religion. Be sure and get the index volume. You look up demons and spirits. Goodness, let me see. Let me look up demons and spirits. Let me show you how to do it. Demons and spirits. Hold on. B, C, D, E. Demons. Let me show you how I do. All right. Now, I'm just going to do this for you right here. I'm going to look up demons and spirits, CD. You can also look up fairies in this, in your index volume, fairies, CD. Now, this is what I'll do at home. D-A-M. Demons and spirits. Wait, D-E. Oh, here it is. Demons and spirits. And it will go into all the cultures of the world. You also want to look up fairies. And it will interchange in the fairies section. It'll interchange demons, jinn, genius. It'll go from one word to another, and they'll call them guardians. And they'll say a guardian ghost of a house. And that was a demon. Even in the V volume, it'll go into vampire and tell you it's a demon. And then it will go into, under the vampire. Vampire's a lot older than Bram Stoker, who wrote Dracula. Way long older. It's thousands of years old. And when you go into the V volume, it'll tell you about vampires, and it'll tell you that they were demons. Now, if there are demons, there are vampires out there, and you'll get bit in the neck. And I'm sorry, there's something worse than there are bloodsuckers out there, Roman Catholics. Now, when you look at demons and spirits in here, in the very first paragraph in the introduction, See, I remember this because I've studied this. Here's what it will say. It will say, Don't I read all of it. The word signifies simply breathing, breath, while the latter, daemon, originally denoted either apportioner, then you get your Webster's Dictionary out and you look up apportion, which means to meet out, M-E-T-E. Meet means to measure out. Has the same meaning as distribute. So it'll say, an apportioner, or less probably apportionment, destiny, means to distribute your destiny or to divide or apportion, to measure out or distribute. When you look up apportion, and then it'll have an introductory section, it'll say introductory. And then it'll begin, and this is why Hastings is so good. It'll go to the next section, and it will say, demon spirits in Assyria and Babylon. It'll tell you all their characteristics. And you're going to find as you read these, as you move from one system to the other, it'll talk about genies, jinn, fairies, guardians. Sometimes it won't call them guardian angels, it'll say they're guardians. And it'll talk about distributing forces, even talk about feeding them at a certain time of the year and leaving food out for them at night, like St. Nicholas. And he was a demon. He was the Roman Catholics call him patron saints, distributing fortunes to children. That's what St. Nicholas was. And then you can look up the T volume and look up totem. And it'll tell you that totem, right immediately in the, see, I've read it over and over. It'll say, totem means kinfolk. That's what they all mean. Genos, that is the word. Kin. Gosh, I could go further and further than that. And then it'll go on and say Buddhist demons and spirits. It'll go on over here. It'll tell you about Celtic demons and spirits. You'll get into fairies and that. Get your F volume out, look up fairies. It'll give you so much information. And this is just one source that I've got. I've got dozens of sources. And then it'll go into Celtic demons and spirits, Christian demons and spirits. It's talking about Roman Catholic, not talking about what we believe. And then it'll go into Egyptian demons and spirits. This is how Hastings is different from McClintock and Strong. It'll go into a culture and just go from one to the other. It'll tell you disposal of the dead, how they disposed among Assyrian and Babylon and among the Christians, among the Jews. Go through the whole thing. And then it'll go over to the Greek demons and spirits. Go to Hebrew demons and spirits. Hebrew, still in that. Indian demons and spirits, not American Indians, but the Indians from India. And all this is on America, on demons and spirits, Indian demons and spirits, Japanese demons and spirits. And you get into Shintoism and ancestor worship, and they'll come up, and the Shintoist will have a shelf with 700 gods on these shelves. And you walk up to them, say, would you like to accept Christ as your personal Savior? Yeah, they'll give me a statue of him, I put him up here with my other gods. It's amazing what people don't know. Japanese demons and spirits. All this is on demons and spirits. Muslim demons and spirits. Goes into Persian demons and spirits. This thing goes on for 100 pages. You understand what I'm saying? People say, where do you come up with it? Slavic demons and spirits. They all come from the same source, Babylon, the mother of harlots. In Babylon, and all of these demons and spirits are nothing but Nimrod and his wife, mother. Sometimes she was his mother, sometimes she was his wife. You say, where do you get that information, Jim? Out of these books and many more. And then you could go into McClintock and Strong. If you can get two sets of books, get the Hastings, get the McClintock and Strong, you'll study forever on these. These were written in the 1800s. They quit putting a lot of the information in McClintock and Strong These came out in the 1800s. The Hastings was printed in about 1906 first. Magnificent. I keep saying this. That's why I needed just to stop and say, I can go over here and just pull out books. I can go over here to the V volume. S-T-U-V. I get the V volume here. Y'all pardon me for being unprofessional. Look at the V volume. Hastings. Maybe this will challenge you to want to get these. I'll go to V. Vampire. Let's look at vampire, okay? If there's such a thing, these guys, they don't put this information anymore in books. You got to go back 100, 110, 15, 20 years. UV. If you go into, you look up utilitarianism, it'll tell you the system that America was built on. And when you look up eudaimonism, EU, D-A-I-M-O-N-I-S-M. See the word daemon? That's our word demon. Demon. Let me show you something. Since there are just a few of us here, you won't mind me doing this. Wait a minute. Let me show you. Let me get a Webster's Dictionary. This is the way I study when I study. I look here and here and here and here and here. Let me look this up, okay? O-P-Q-R-S-T-U, E-U, E-C-D-E. When I'm studying, this is the way I study. Go from one book to the other. Constantly read. Just read through everything. Let me see here. E-U. Y'all don't mind me doing this, do you? Maybe it'll help you understand why I want you to get this. Now, it says right here, this is Webster's New World Dictionary. If you get a Webster's, get a New World Dictionary, it'll tell you the words it comes from. Now, look here. Let me get my pen. I'm going to write the word on the board. I went to the E. E-U-D-A-E-M-O-N-I-A. Eudaimonia. Then under that, it's got U-D-A-I-M-O-N-I-S-M. You see the U, that means well, doesn't it? Well, demon. That means a well demon is what it means. Well, let me read this to you. Well, demon. Greek, eudaimonia. The definition is happiness. It means to have a well distribution of fortunes, happiness, blessed with good genius, fortunate, daemon, happiness or well-being, philosophy, happiness, well-being, the main universal goal, distinct from pleasure, derived from the life of activity, governed by reason. Don't sound like something evil, does it? That's in a Webster's Dictionary. Then, eudaimonism. From the Greek, eudaimonismos, a calling happy, to call happy, the ethical doctrine that personal happiness is the chief good. Don't sound like something evil, does it? Is the chief good, the proper aim of action, such happiness conceived of in terms of well-being based on virtuous and rational self-realization or self-esteem. Wow. That's kind of surprising, isn't it? And if you go into here, I've got a biography of Thomas Jefferson, and it says that Thomas Jefferson started our nation on eudaimonism, the good demon. And they say it means that this word eudaimonism is a synonym for welfare. Welfare. And then if you go into the word utilitarianism, U-T-I-L, utilitarianism, It will tell you it is a synonym for eudaimonism. And I happen to flip open the page here. Utilitarianism right there. But you're not even going to know that. I search and search and search, and it'll say, see utilitarianism. So I go see it, and I find out what it means. These are great books. These are printed in 1906. Now, I was going to go over here to, gosh, I start reading this, and it makes me want to stop and start through it. Now, let me look up vampire, okay? How much time do I have, Mike?
33.
All right. Now, let me go to vampire, okay? Hastings Encyclopedia of Religion, 13 volumes. Be sure and get the index volume. L-M-V-A-M. All right. Vampires go way back into antiquity. If you're going to look up vampires and werewolf is going to be there under the term lycanthropy. People think, you made all that up, Jim Brown. Gosh, I read like I'm a voracious reader. I love to read. I walk around the house with a book in my hand. I keep them on the kitchen table. I'm picking them up, reading them constantly. I may read a page or two, set it down, go do something in the house, go take the dogs out, come back, read another page on some other book, and then read some other pages, go up to my library, pull some books out, lay them out on the table, look at some stuff, go through them. I don't ever quit. Is that boasting? No, I've been given that desire by God to read this way. And when you read, you're going, oh, wow. And the amount of interest is phenomenal. When you look at, gosh, I can't even get to all of it, lycanthropy. Lycanthropy is what we would call werewolves. And that's shape shifting. Shape shifting goes back into the ancient world. I've said before that the gods, you can go into, let me see, this is the way I do at home. I look at my books and I'll say, let me see, where's that book on, here it is. No, not the Sabbaths. But I've got one on, here. E. Dane McCoy, written by a witch. She will tell you, and she has historical truth. They will agree. A witch will say, we don't fly around on brooms, we worship nature. And they agree with Hastings. She'll agree with Hastings on what it's about. Witches were not hook-nosed hags that had warts all over their nose that flew around on a broom. That wasn't a witch. Thou shalt not suffer a witch to live. The word is kasaf. It means one who whispers, talks smooth, and that's while they're distributing fortunes to you, all that's in the world. But that's called a con in our language. It's called a con artist. Lycanthropy is what they called moonstruck. In Matthew, the 17th chapter, a man brings his son to Jesus and said, my son is lunatic. Lunatic comes from lunar, which is the word moon. The man said, my son is moonstruck. Did the man know what he was talking about? No. He was simply going by the culture of the day. If you had epilepsy, you say he has a demon, he's moonstruck. Well, the werewolf and the lycanthropy, this is shape-shifting, and E. Dane McCoy said that, and you're going to get this out of Hastings as well, that King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table were thinly veiled sun and tree goddesses. And when you get into Lancelot, you get into King Arthur, you get into the Arthurian legend, you look up Arthurian legend in Hastings. And then it'll say, see Merlin. You go to Merlin, and it will say Merlin could, he was the magician, and he could change himself into a wolf. And that's Moonstruck. Where is the first time that a being was turned into an animal? Genesis 3. The serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field, and Satan was inhabiting the serpent. There's where the moonstruck begins. The man said, my son is moonstruck. He is struck by the moon. And he wasn't. And Jesus said, this kind goeth not out by prayer and fasting. Kind is the word genos. Jesus said, you think that you're kin folks, and it's not. He probably had epilepsy, falling into the fire. So when you get into moonstruck, you get into vampires. And if you get the Hastings, you can research this all day long, all night long, for month after month after month. Believe it or not, I've done a lot of that. People say, you make up this stuff. There's such a thing as demons. You need to get you some Hastings and research everything. And every time it says see, then see it. I've looked this stuff up. Listen, vampire. This is before they made any movies. Can you see vampire right there? You have good eyes. Vampire. You don't have to come up, Tim. Can you see that? It says vampire. This is 1906. This is before Bram Stoker wrote Dracula in the 1800s, but all he did was play off the old superstition of the ancient world. And it says, a vampire may be defined as the spirit of a dead person or his corpse reanimated by his own spirit or by a demon. Golly. And it goes on and on. And here's how you capture a vampire. Right here. And it goes into vampires and werewolves. We're talking long before the movies come out. They didn't have movies back then when these were printed. They didn't even have silent movies in 1906. They were just inventing them about that time. Now listen to this. Sometimes also the head of the vampire was cut off. The heads of murderers, whose spirits the living feared, were also cut off and destroyed, or set between the legs and beneath the body. Another effectual way to get rid of a vampire was to burn the corpse to ashes, but care was taken to drive back into the fire every creature which might come out of it, worms, snakes, beetles, birds, lest the vampire should have embodied itself into them and you get bit by a bird in the neck. I just added that part in. And so resume its foul work. This was done among the Slavs, and remember Vlad the Impaler was a Slavic prince, and he slaughtered his enemies and hung thousands of them on, impaled them on stakes. That's back in the Middle Ages. But vampires go long before Vlad the Impaler. And in Bulgaria, which is those Balkan states, the Balkan states is up here. Yugoslavia. Ah, come to me, my dear, and I'll bite you in the neck. That's supposed to be a Slavic accent. And that's where they did that because Vlad the Impaler was Slavic. And that's why, what's his name that played the old vampire movie? Bela Lugosi would talk like that, like he was from Yugoslavia. I love to count. 1, 2, 3, 4. I love the count on Sesame Street. He's one of my favorite characters of all time. 1 light bulb. 2. You know how far this goes? Endless. The study is endless. People want to get mad at me because I say there's no demons. The demon is you. Now listen to this. All right, lest these bugs and beetles become vampires. This was done among the Slavs, and in Bulgaria, a sorcerer armed with a saint's picture. That's a Roman Catholic saint, not the Apostle Paul, somebody painting him, A Roman Catholic saint's picture is supposed to drive the vampire into a bottle. Where do you drive a genie? Into a bottle, don't you? Boy, that has so much significance. Into a bottle containing some of its foul food, and when corked up, the bottle is thrown into the fire. In Greece, any corpse which is found not having suffered dissolution, as well as any suspected of being a vampire, was even now and still is exhumed, cut to pieces, and burned. To prevent its further wandering as a revenant, boiling water or oil was poured on the grave, and the heart was torn out of the body and dissolved in vinegar. This is a reversion to the old pagan custom of cremation of the dead, and in spite of Slavic influences, the Slavic method of staking the body is not in use. And it goes on and gets on and on. Driving it into a bottle, why? Gosh, that's not hard. If you study it, if you've got the set of books, if you got the set of books that's equivalent to Kittle's New Testament Dictionary of Greek Words in the Old Testament, which I've got those, and I looked this up in that set of books. And this is the way I study. I'm accused of making this stuff up. I think people are funny. I looked up the word bottle. That's where you put a genie, and that's where you put a vampire. I looked up the word actually familiar spirit. Familiar spirit. In the Old Testament, it is the word ob, which is the word bottle. Now, but when they had a bottle, they didn't mean what we mean by a bottle. They didn't mean something like this. That's not what they meant. Made of glass. Wasn't a bottle. A bottle was a goat's stomach that was cut out. They would dry the stomach, and they would put a stopper on one end and put the other end where they could take it off, where they could drink out of it. They put a strap on it. And you see people carrying those bottles on their back in the Middle East. That's a bottle. That's what they keep their wines in, their grape juices. And they had learned ventriloquism. Ventriloquist. That's talking. That's pretending. That's a guy has a dummy on his knee and he's talking to this dummy by, they called it peeping and muttering. They would talk in a high voice like this and pretend that they were talking to the dead. And they would talk to the dead in that bottle. And they said what was in the bottle was a demon or an ancestor, which was guiding you to good fortune, back to demons, distributing fortunes, good fortunes, or genies giving you the three wishes, or fairies giving your wishes. And the word wish, this is what I do when I'm studying. I just decided one day to look up the word wish. So let's look at the word wish in a Webster's dictionary, okay? I'll tell you what it comes from. It's TVW. People say, can you teach me how to study? You won't have to follow me around in my house. I'll go get this book, that book, this book, look up this word, that word. My mind keeps going from one place to the other. This is the way I study. And once it gets interesting, you don't want to quit, especially when you get on a trail like this. Let's look here at wish. All right. And some of the things you look up in Webster Dictionary, you're going, whoa. It's like, wow. All right. Y'all mind me doing this? This is the way I study. I don't look scholarly. I look like some common guy, and I am. You know what the word scholar means? Student. That's all it means. I'm a student of the Word, and I never quit learning. Nobody is an expert. If you think you've learned all about demons that you can learn, you have. If you think you've learned all about baptism you learned, you have. If you don't ever believe you arrive at a brick wall and there's more avenues to go, you keep learning. Wish, W-I-S-H, wish. First time I read this, I went, golly, wow. Out of Webster Dictionary. It comes from the Old English, or Middle English, wissen, Old English, wiscan. It's the Latin word Venus. Whoa! What are the wishes? All that's in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. And Venus was called a demon among the Jews, and a genie among the Arabs, among the Celts. Whatever name she took on in any given area, she was the distributor of fortunes. Now, you'd have to drive a vampire into a bottle. You have to put a genie in the bottle. And all this goes, I've got books on fairies. I'm not talking about fairy tale fairies. But by the way, all fairy tales originated in sun and tree worship, including Cinderella, Rapunzel, all the rest of these. These were fairy tales or demon tales. And they have to do with sun worship. I got one book just on fairy tales, and it gives you these fairy tales and tells you that when the sun was coming up, when Cinderella comes in, and she's a picture of distributing fortunes, and it goes into the prince being a picture of the one who distributes to her, and all of this. It's like, wow. You get into any fairy tales, they all originated in fairies or demons. Fairies and demons are the same thing. Well, this was a bottle. They learned ventriloquism, and they said they were talking to the dead in the bottle. And that's ventriloquism. Ventriloquism. And that's called necromancy. And anyone who talking to the dead in a bottle, the penalty was death. You know why? Not because they were talking to the dead, because they were conning somebody, pretending to talk to their dead ancestors. When they translated the word bottle, you've heard me say this before, but it goes with what I'm talking about how to study. When they translated, when the translators, 200 BC, and here's where history works in. Here's where history works in. Alexander the Great lived from around 332 BC to 320 BC, and he'd given all of, here you are, 300 BC, given all of the world, all of its philosophy, its culture, and given its languages, its gloss and dialects, that's the words, translated tongue, the electos, how here we ever man and own dialect when we were born. They all spoke with other tongues, heteroglossa, other foreign languages, as the Spirit gave them utterance. By the time you get to 200 BC, over 100 years after Alexander the Great's dead, he's given all the world all of its Greek languages. So the Jews said, we've got to take the Old Testament Hebrew text and we've got to translate it into Greek since all the world is speaking some form of the Greek language. So they translated it, took 70 translators. LXX is 70 among the Roman numerals. And when you see LXX, that stands for Septuagint, which is the translation of the Hebrew text into the Greek. Nearly all scholars will tell you Septuagint is the best translation of anything that's ever been done, closest that can be done, because the men translating it were Jews. They were authorities on Hebrew and Greek. When they got to the word familiar spirit, familiar spirit, they translated familiar spirit, which is the word ob in the Hebrew, bottle. And a bottle was a goat's stomach, dried out. This is out of my Old Testament equivalent to the Kittles New Testament Dictionary of Greek Words. It's the Old Testament Hebrew words. I went in there and took the word ob and translated, familiar spirit. This is how these brilliant translators translated familiar spirit, E-N-G-A-S-T-R-O-M-U-T-H-O-S. That's the way they translated familiar spirit. These guys lived 200 B.C. They were brilliant in languages. And this is the construction. This is familiar spirit. This is the way these men 200 B.C. translated the word familiar spirit, E-N-G-A-S-T-R-O. Do you have gastrointestinal problems? Do you have stomach problems? Gastro is the word stomach, a reference to the goat's stomach, which is a bottle, and muthos. Muthos is the word myth. Every time Paul would speak of avoid vain fables, it's myth. It means a myth within the stomach of the goat. It's a fable. Vampires are fables. It's just not true. You want to learn to study these things. You go into here. I have taken the section on fairies. I've gone through it over and over and over and marked it up. It'll give you everything unbelievable in it. It'll give you distributing fortunes, gin, genies, and it'll interchange all of these. And I hope you can, if you can get this, I quote the McClintock and Strong all the time. These are two sets of books. Fantastic books. Get you into history like you wouldn't believe. I know everybody doesn't have the time, and it takes a certain kind of hunger to go into this. I hunger for these facts all the time. I am so tired of Pentecostalism and their demons and their tongues and their... Nobody cares what anything means. I'll tell you where you can get a good set of these right here. You can get a real good set. If you watch Jimmy Swaggart, he's got a set right over his right shoulder in his bookshelf, and I'm sure he's never looked at them. And write to him and ask him if he'll sell them to you for $150. He's got a set of McClintock Strong right over his right shoulder. I'm going, Jimmy, pick those up and look at them. I hope you can see what I'm saying. I'll put these up in a minute. How much time do I have, Mike? 11. All you got to do is study. That's all. That's all you got to do. Hold on a minute. I never know what I'm going to want or what I'm going to need. So I bring all this stuff with me. Sometimes I thumb through. I know what I got in there. And I have gone, believe it or not, I know what all this is when I thumb through it. I thought I had something on fairies in here. I go into Life and Times of Jesus the Messiah, which is by Alfred Edersheim. And whenever I'm teaching on proselyte baptism, I'll make copies out of it. And then I'll start through, and I'll go back in the back, in the index. I'll look at the index, and I'll go to the section that says proselyte. And you've heard me teach on the three things that makes a man a proselyte: washing in water. I think because I don't look the part and I dress in some Levi's and a sports shirt, people think, well, you can't be that smart. You've got to have on a suit and a watch fob. You don't have to be smart. All you have to do is read. When the picture starts coming together, you want to read more and research more. But you got to have the tools. The two sets of tools I recommend highly is Hastings and McClintock and Strong. Get those. You can study 100 lifetimes with these and you'll never absorb them all. Never. We just don't print that kind of information anymore. But whenever I tell you that water washing, in order to be a proselyte, when Jesus tells the Pharisees, you come up to sin land to make one proselyte. Well, I want to know what a proselyte is, so I figured years ago I better look it up. So I start looking at all of my books, and I go into Life and Times of Jesus the Messiah. If you try to read this, it's very difficult, but if you open it up to the index and use it like a dictionary, like an encyclopedia, and look up the subject, it'll give you the subject, what page it's on, and then you can go back over to that page, and I'll go to my copy machine and just make a bunch of copies of that chapter. Then I'll start through and I'll mark it up. You can see I start marking it. I'm marking this chapter. I've gone through all this that you can see. And then I get over here to a section on, and I'll read before that page that's got the proselyte on it. You've heard me say that if a person was going to come into Israel and become a member of the kingdom of God, which was a term for Israel, because God was their king all through the Old Testament. And I'm reading here about proselyte baptism. I'm not going to read all of it, but just a little bit. What John preached, that he also symbolized by a rite, which though not in itself, yet in its application was wholly new, hitherto the law had it that those who had contracted Levitical defilement were to immerse before offering sacrifice. And I've said that. I've said all the priests, these things come together. All the priests would go to the, they would put on their white robes. They would go, here's the temple. There's the veil. Here's the Ark of the Covenant. Seven candlesticks. Altar of incense. Table of showbread up here. And then the altar up here, all the sacrifice offered. And they would go and wash in this brazen sea. At one time it was called a laver because when Israel multiplied and had more priests, they had to make a sea out of it. It had 2,000 baths. That's not something I made up. It's funny. People think, you make that up. Don't make up anything. I will verify everything in all of the tools that I have. They'd wash every morning and then they'd go to sacrifice. They implemented that into the proselyte process. That's what Mr. Edersheim says. Hitherto, let me say again, it was prescribed that such Gentiles who became proselytes of righteousness or proselytes of the covenant were to be admitted to full participation in privileges of Israel by a threefold rite. You've heard me say this. Of circumcision, baptism or water washing, and sacrifice. The immersion being, as it were, the acknowledgement of symbolic removal of moral defilement, which they did at the temple, corresponding to that of Levitical uncleanness, but never before had it been proposed that Israel should undergo a baptism of repentance. But the water washing wasn't the baptism of repentance. John said, I baptize you with water. And that was a proselyte washing. And Jesus wanted to win a proselyte washing. Don't want to go into it, don't even have time. You want to know how I study? This is how I study. I go from one book to the other. I go from one index to the other. And I always look things up in McClintock and Strong and in Hastings. And you want to look up swastika? Swastika was the wheel of the ear. You get your index volume, look up the S, look up swastika, and it'll tell you it was the Big Dipper. Duh. And I don't have time to go on that. Hitler didn't invent the swastika. And I go in here and I go to dozens of other books. You need to get, everybody needs to get about 12 items. You need a McClintock and Strong. You need the Hastings. You need Mr. Edersheim's books, Life and Times of Jesus the Messiah. Look in the index. The Sketches of the Jewish Social Life by Edersheim. That'll tell you everyday life, what they did. And then you'll find out how it matches up with Scripture. And then they'll tell you, then he's got a book called The Templist Ministry and Services. Wonderful book. Great book. I've gotten so much out of that. Cup of Blessing. You'll get that out of The Templist Ministry and Services. That was the title for the third cup of the Passover. The cup of blessing which we bless is not the communion of the blood of Christ. Boy, that's got so much significance to it. And then he's got one called The History of Israel. In The History of Israel is where you get to the 18th chapter of 1 Kings where Elijah's facing off the priests of Baal, and Mr. Edersheim will say how ridiculous these priests of Baal looked in their tall, pointed white bonnets and their white robes. You're going, wow, that's a clan. And that's the clan has their uniforms that goes back to the priests of Baal. And they worship the Big Dipper. So wherever you find the Big Dipper, you're going to find the swastika. That was the wheel of the year. Notice how these things just tie together. And that was the wheel of the year. And you can look it up in here. One guy wrote me an email. And he said, I looked up Big Dipper on the internet, and there it was, the swastika right there. It was called the wheel of the year. And it said it'd be turned by the Queen of Heaven, and Israel was being condemned for worshiping the Queen of Heaven in Jeremiah the 44th chapter and Jeremiah the 7th chapter. And you can find all this stuff. People want, information is not going to come out and jump at you. It's not going to knock, it's not going to beat a door to your doorstep, beat a path to your doorstep. You got to look for it. And the Big Dipper was this right here. Right here. And you can get it in all kinds of these books. Like so. And they said the Queen of Heaven, or one of the demons, was up in the heavens turning this wheel of the year to get it from summer all the way through winter, back through the spring, so they could have crops. You can look that up in Hastings. I've run out of time. Am I out?
Yeah.
I don't know why I just left the subject and got on how I study. If you'll get the Hastings, McClintock and Strong, get Mr. Edersheim's books, get at least, Edersheim's going to tell you about Jewish culture. Adolf Deismann in his Life in the Ancient East is going to tell you about Greek culture. And they lived in a world ruled by the Romans with Greek culture, current Greek culture, and the Jews had their culture that was thousands of years old. So you got these three things you got to know about. You need a good set of commentaries, maybe Matthew Poole, Matthew Henry. And I don't agree with everything they say in it, but those are good reformers, and they believe predestination to a degree. You're not going to find somebody that believes everything you believe. That's like saying, I'm not going to take algebra unless I find a man that teaches algebra that believes in predestination, then you won't ever take it. This is how I study the Bible. And I know what all these papers are, believe it or not. I know generally what's on them. And I bring this whole packet with me, so in case I might want something out of it, I'll know what's in there. I know I've got the fairy paper in here. You know what's wrong with the world? They don't define nothing. They don't know anything. Just dumb. Preachers are just rockheads. Have the slightest idea what they're talking about. And I've spent a lifetime studying, and preachers don't study at all. And I pick up something, I don't want to start talking about it. I want to start talking about that right there, but I don't have no more time. Well, let's pray. Lord, thank you for truth. God help us to continue this work, to get this message out. I don't know how much the world wants, Lord. I'll give them all I can get, Lord. Thank you for giving me a hunger over these years. And Lord, I know that's just a gift. It's nothing a man can boast in. Let me impart this to the people. Lead us to your elect family. God, I truly pray that you'll be merciful and open up the doors for these elect. There's a world of people out there that's looking for truth. It's a world of the elect. You know that. I don't tell you that. You know that. I pray you'll let us be a part of it throughout the world. I pray you'll fight our battles. I can't fight them, Lord. I'm not capable of fighting people. Too tired, Lord. I'm not supposed to be doing it anyway. God, will praise you for everything. In Christ's name we pray, amen. I hope that helps some on how I study.
Jim, I looked up the that book. It's on Google Books, like a PDF.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
David? Dave. Bye.
See you later.
I love you, brother. If you can get these Hastings, they are fantastic.
Yeah, I've got to get those. I ended up getting the,
huh?
I got the McClendon and Strong's out there at McKay's at $2 a book.
Really? $2 a book?
$2.
Are you kidding?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, I got them.
That is a steal.
Yeah, so, but you're right. You're looking at that.
If you can find these. These don't read the same as McClintock and Strong. They usually take every culture and go through a subject on like dozens of cultures. Just like I was talking about demons and spirits. And people think, well, I didn't see that out of McClintock and Strong. Well, that ain't all I use. I didn't get that out of Strong's. Well, you're not going to get, all you're going to get out of Strong's on Daemonion is distribute fortunes. That's all you're going to get. Under Dio, distribute fortunes. But it'll also say deity. When it says deity, a deity is a god. They call their gods by the term of Daemonion. That's what, when Paul got to, in the 17th chapter of Acts, when he got to Athens, and he's talking to these Epicureans and he's preaching, they said, this man is speaking of strange gods, and the word gods there is daemonion. That proves that they call their gods by the term of demons. And Paul said in the 10th chapter of 1 Corinthians, these people at Corinth are offering sacrifices unto devils, and the word is daemonion. Paul says their gods are demons. They said they were demons. He said they were demons.
And this talks a little bit something like
it's
yeah, that fits right in.
There's so much superstition in the world. It's insane.
It talks about Anthony and all these different ones.
But it's interesting when you start finding out about it, isn't it?
Spell Borgus for me.
What?
Borgus.
What is it?
You said the movie's The Borgia.
Oh, B-O-R-G-I-A. Borgia.
About brutish.
Right.
Dull of hearing, you know.
Hey.
It's like he was talking about
what doing?
A long time ago.
Right.
Huh?
Charlie,
let me put my books up.
Hey, it was so hard.
Hey, Gwen. What are you doing?
Yeah, I remember.
It's funny you mentioned a lot of the impeller.
Yeah.
They actually made a most recent Dracula movie, and they based it on Vlad the Impaler.
Well, he was the more current. He wasn't the oldest. I mean, the oldest is way back years ago.
Where'd you look?
The vampires go back into ancient antiquity long before Christ. And they were called Moonstruck. My son is lunatic. He's Moonstruck. When you go over to Job said, if I kiss the hand and I beheld the moon in its brightness, that's what the Roman Catholics do. They kiss the hand. He said, then this also is an evil, and God will hold me accountable for this. It all goes back to superstition, imagination. This they began to do, now they can be restrained from their imagination.